In an earlier video, Michael Coomer asked trustees to create the ideal library for their community. Making that vision a reality requires careful planning. We asked Michael to tell us more.
Well, planning is job one for trustees. And the way we take that paradigm and translate it into an operational imperative is that the meetings themselves that the trustees have should all be planning meetings. So what we suggest is to a trustee, imagine that every board meeting you had was, in essence, a planning meeting. And the measure of success of the board meeting is that when we walk out the door at the end of an hour and a half or a two-hour board meeting, we will feel that we have made two or three giant steps in the direction of realizing our vision for the future of the library and the community that it exists to serve. That's job one, and that's how they take planning and actually put it into an operational construct.
As you can tell, Michael is always looking to the future to improve upon the past. Doug agrees.
Well, first, you know, there is the library as it does exist, and there's the library as it did exist. And trustees should be very focused on the library as it needs to exist.
To ensure that you have time for planning, meetings must be run efficiently. Michael recommends sending material to trustees in advance of scheduled meeting dates, giving them time to read the material prior to the meeting and arrive prepared. The board can then use the time it would have spent on reviewing reports to answer the question, what are the next steps we should take towards reaching our goals?
Of the managerial work of the board, which comes after its central leadership responsibility, which, as we have discussed, is creating an exciting future for the community that the library exists to serve, the first managerial responsibility is to making sure that the board is functioning on an A++++ level at all times. To make sure that the board is functioning at the highest possible level starts with the recruitment of outstanding individuals to serve on the board. In order to attract those outstanding individuals, they want to come to a board that enjoys meetings, enjoys a conversation that is the highest possible level of aspiration and inspiration. In other words, it's hard to attract really great people to a board meeting if the majority of time is spent on reviewing reports and talking about things that have already happened. But if they know they're going to come to a board meeting and they're going to talk about what we want to see happen for the future of the library, and then they're going to plot the steps in order to create that idealized future, that makes it exciting for a dynamic individual to serve on a library board of directors. The role of the chair of the board, fundamentally, is to choreograph those board meetings to make sure that they are thrilling experiences in and of themselves, so that when a terrific, dynamic individual walks out of the board meeting at the end of the evening, he or she is able to say, we're two or three giant steps closer to realizing that goal we've articulated for the library.
By focusing on major issues, the board will have adequate time for discussion and consideration.
I think basically every board meeting to some degree is a planning meeting. I think that I enjoy board meetings where we do a lot less discussion of the nuts and bolts, and we set aside, which our board does now, we set aside a time where we can discuss one or two key issues facing the library at this point in time, and we get to really have a discussion and really do some planning, to your point. You know, planning is just not a once and done thing. Planning is an ongoing process. And I think the board meetings is the one time we have the opportunity to really draw on from everyone on a certain issue. And I think there should be time set aside to do that.
The excitement in a board meeting comes from sharing your opinions and listening to what others have to say. Because your board should be representative of the community, there will be varied perspectives that may help the board make the best possible decisions. When all board members are present and actively participating in the meeting, you have the perfect environment for hearing all points of view and making collective decisions based on that input. Any individual who agrees to serve as a library trustee is also making a commitment to regularly attend board meetings and take part in board activities. If an issue arises which poses a conflict of interest for one or more trustees, it's advised that those trustees leave the room during the discussion and return when the group moves on to the next issue. By leaving the room, you allow the other trustees the privacy they may need to speak openly about the issue.
The reason that a trustee needs to be attending these meetings is more than just staying current on the topics, old business and new business. There is a synergy that's created when you get a board together. Topics can be discussed live and face-to-face. Nuances can be picked up that you don't get from an email conversation. There are more mundane things that can be discussed and prepared for through email, and that would probably be more of the day-to-day logistics, things that have to be addressed. There's nothing wrong with being prepared coming into a meeting. But when you've got sensitive issues, when you've got long-term plans, those are the areas that the board focuses most of their time and their attention, then they do need to be in together as a group. The tone, of course, is set by the president, but that means you're also going to have dissenting views on how things should be handled. I want to hear the views of the other people. It's very likely my view might shift. I might be able to bring something to the table someone else hasn't considered yet. And at that point, you have as much information out there as possible to make the best decision collectively as a group.
At times, it's best to use the committee structure to address certain issues or topics and have the committee bring information to the full board. This time-saving model also allows for best use of each trustee's areas of expertise.
One of the things we notice that is characteristic of most boards is that they are MM boards, and MM stands for micromanage. So often what happens is they use the full board meeting to review reports, and they use them to make tactical decisions about the future of the library. That's a contradiction of everything we've talked about so far, because we want them to use those meetings to plan for the future, a future defined as at least 3 to 5 years out. Well, some of the oversight work still has to occur, and a good way for it to occur in a way that meaningfully engages the trustees is through the committee structure. So we delegate to the committees aspects of the tactical decisions of managing the board, having the board's oversight responsibility in place, and so on. So you might have one committee that would serve as the governance committee, recruiting and retaining outstanding people to serve on the board. You might have another one, the committee serving as the finance committee, and that in within the finance committee structure, they would oversee that the library director is spending the funds available in accordance with the mission of the library. And then perhaps a third committee would be what we might call the library director support committee. And that's the committee that would negotiate those annual goals in close collaboration with the library director, and during the course of the year would meet with the library director regularly on both a formal and informal basis, and they would answer the question, how can we help you meet and exceed those goals? Well, if we delegate those fundamental tasks to committees, then the full board, when it meets for board meetings, can spend the vast majority of its time, energy, and attention talking about the future of the library and the community that it exists to serve.
Future action depends on your library's future trustees. For that reason, it's critical to have a governance committee. Some may refer to it as a nominating committee. Others may call it a board development or board strengthening committee. Regardless of its name, everyone agrees that it's one of the most important committees.
Serving on the governance committee is a privilege. It's a privilege that typically is delegated to the very best members of the board, because their job then is to perpetuate the future of the board and make sure that every year the board is better than the current year. And they do that largely by recruiting the very, very best people that the community has to offer to serve on the board of directors. Now, there's an interesting exercise the governance committee members can use with the full board. And the exercise is, think about somebody who is your personal hero. Either somebody that you've met and collaborated with in your life, perhaps a historical figure that you've read about, and then talk about the qualities you associate with that heroic individual. Most board members enjoy playing this very serious game, or I should say with a game with a very serious intention. And so they all come up with a series of descriptive terms, and that has to do with personal integrity, character, courage, the capacity for vision for the future, a willingness to take occasionally an unpopular stand, and then the list continues. When the board generates that list with the governance committee takes that list and that becomes the criteria that they use for the recruitment of new board members. Now it's important to note that the process takes a long time. You can't do that in a few weeks before those annual elections are supposed to transpire. So good governance committees will start months and months and months prior to the date when the election of new board members occurs. And they'll talk about, number one, what is the criteria that we're looking for? Number two, let's create a large pool of potential candidates. And then let's take several months to screen those individuals in order to ensure that only the best of the best of the best are going to have their names placed in nomination to join the board of directors. The question we want them to answer is, if that's what you would use as the criteria for hiring the library director, why would you use anything else for deciding who the bosses of the library director are going to be?
Current and future trustees may also serve on other valuable committees, such as buildings and grounds, advocacy, finance, public relations, policies, and others as needed. The board agenda should include adequate time for committee reports. Here are some other tips for effective, productive meetings. Provide reading material at least a few days in advance of the board meeting so members may come prepared. Create and follow an agenda which prioritizes issues for discussion. Your most pressing issue, problem, or opportunity should be the focus of the meeting. Arrive promptly. Understand that the library director is an ex officio member of the board and all board committees. He or she should attend and participate in all meetings, and his or her counsel should be considered seriously when the board makes decisions. In addition to asking the director's opinion, the board should encourage trustees to share their opinions and show respect for those which may differ from yours. Ensure that your board's bylaws are followed and update them as needed. Strive to speak in the interest of the board, rather than personal interests. Respect and follow the group's decisions. Celebrate your achievements.
You always need cheerleaders. You always need people who are, you know, rigorously saying, you know, don't worry about it. I know it's hard now, but we're going to move to the future. We're going to do this. We can do this.
We have a blast at the libraries. Then we leave.